Silence in us any voice but your own, that hearing we may also obey your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Morning.
Morning.
The Old Testament reading today is from Isaiah chapter 58, verses 1 through 12, which you can find on page 688 of the Pew Bible. Shout out, do not hold back. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Announce to my people their rebellion, to the house of Jacob their sins. Yet day after day they seek me and delight to know my ways, as if they were a nation that practiced righteousness and did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask of me righteous judgments. They delight to draw near to God. Why do we fast, but you do not see? Why humble ourselves, but you do not notice? Look, you serve your own interest on your fasting and oppress all your workers. Look, you fast only to quarrel and to fight and to strike with a wicked fist. Such fasting as you do today will not make your voice heard on high. Is such the fast that I choose, a day to humble oneself? Is it to bow down the head like a bulrush, and to lie in sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and to bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see them naked, to cover them and not to hide yourself from your own kin. Then your light shall break forth like the dawn and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help and he will say, here I am. If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom be like the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places and make your bones strong, and you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live. The epistle is 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 16, which you can find on page 166 of the Pew Bible. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words or wisdom. For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I came to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. My speech and my proclamation were not with plausible words of wisdom, but with the demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might rest not on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Yet among the mature, we do speak wisdom, though it is not the wisdom of this age, or of the rulers of this age, who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him, these things God has revealed to us through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For what human being knows what is truly human, except the human spirit that is within? So also no one comprehends what is truly God's, except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit that is from God, so that we may understand the gifts bestowed on us by God. And we speak of these things in words not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual things to those who are spiritual. Those who are unspiritual do not receive the gifts of God's Spirit, and they are unable to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. Those who are spiritual discern all things, and they are themselves subject to no one else's scrutiny. For who has known the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. And our final reading for today is from Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 through 20, which is on page 4. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill it. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter, will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven.
Grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are salt. You are light. You are a city set upon a hill. This is who Jesus says you are. This is who Jesus says you are individually and corporately as the Church of Jesus Christ. What would that mean, I wonder, to the multitudes, to the crowds, hearing that original sermon? What would be suggested when Jesus said, you are salt? Looking at the scripture and looking at the writings of that period, I would agree with my good colleague's children's sermon. I would agree that salt is used in Job, the Old Testament book, to flavor food. It brings out the best, the zest, the flavor of the food, Job says. It acts as a preservative so that which is nutritious can be held onto for the times of famine, for the times of thinness. Salt, so says Sirach, is necessary for life. Without salt, there is no life, Sirach says. Salt, Esdras says, is used to avoid destruction. Salt is used when a solemn covenant is established between kingdoms. It is sealed in salt, more so when covenant exists between God and us. Salt was used to proclaim the covenant. Second Chronicles speaks of there being a specific covenant of salt. Salt symbolized binding relationship and binding commitments of the most noble and significant manner. The prophet Ezekiel speaks of childbirth and that newborn children were rubbed with salt. It is a symbol of the claiming and the embrasure of new life. In the rabbinic writings of the period, salt is expressly used for consummate wisdom. It is a metaphor for having attained the purest, strongest quintessence of wisdom available. You are salt. God has chosen you. God has embraced you. God has given you new life. God has given you wisdom. You are a preservative of God. You are the people who know what life and all that zest is about. You have the wisdom of God at your disposal. You are salt. Wow! What an image to share with the people of Israel. But, Jesus says, if it has lost its flavor, if it has become marano in the Greek, what good is it but to be trampled underfoot? To lose its flavor, this Greek word that I just tried to articulate, was also a euphemism used at the time for not only losing your flavor, but losing your mind. Isn't that great? Salt, if it loses its flavor, if you lose your wisdom, if you lose your mind, if you chuck it all away, all it's good for is to be trampled underfoot. Trampling underfoot was also a euphemism for the judgment of God. If you have been given so much, you salty old church, you, if you lose your wisdom, you who have been given so much, you will be trampled underfoot in the judgment of God. You are light. The usual Palestinian home had a very small window, maybe one, often none. They understood what light was for. To go into your house to find your way, you needed to have a lamp. You needed to have that lamp up high to illumine the area. It was put on a shelf or it was suspended from the ceiling up high to show you where your stuff was so you wouldn't break your neck tripping over it, where you could still navigate and understand how to live and how to do and how to be. You are light. But no one in their right mind puts a lamp under a bushel basket, a small basket to measure grain tightly woven together. No one would do that. You want your light to shine. You are light. Shine, Jesus says. Let your light shine. You are a city set upon a hill. Well, that would have been one of those sayings that everyone would have winked and got. It was saying, you are the living Jerusalem. That's the city on a hill, you know. Sure, the Romans may be around, and the Zealots may be around, and there may be all kinds of political turmoil, but don't you forget where the true Jerusalem is. You are a city set on the hill. You are the true Jerusalem. You are the living temple of God. Claim your holiness through the grace of Jesus Christ. You are salt in covenant relationship with God, receiving God's wisdom. You are light, demonstrating where all the difficulties are, knowing how to navigate and proceed with wisdom. You are a city on a hill. You are a living tabernacle. Wow. I wonder how often we get up And think of these words that Jesus proclaimed. I wonder how often we start our day off claiming the identity that God graciously gives us in Jesus Christ. I wonder how often, as we look at our day planners or our schedules or the calendar on the refrigerator, we say, well, where shall I be salty today? Where shall I be light? Where shall I be a city set up on a hill? Jesus said that he came to fulfill the law. He came to fulfill the law, and that word in Greek means to embody the best of the tradition, the best of the law, the best of the law and the prophets. He was the living law fulfilled. And he calls us to fulfill the same. How you doing? How's your salt? How's your light? How's your city on a hill? This declaration isn't become more salty. It says you are salt. It isn't become more light-like. It's you are light. Do not go through reconstruction. You are the city set on a hill. You individually, with the gift of your life, and we, the church, corporately together. It is the most profound identity statement of who we are, who Jesus sees us being. Where are we as a congregation? Salt. Where are we as a congregation? Light. Where are we a city set on the hillside as a congregation? We definitely have the hillside. This is the question that we must ask ourselves. Where are we a living embodiment of all that the law and prophets would have us be and do? I had a pleasant chat yesterday with a pastor who was present at the funeral service. He was Hugh's brother-in-law. And of course, in due course, we started talking about what we were going to preach on today. So I said to him, how are you going to close your sermon? He says, well, the church in Annapolis has a rich tradition. They have sponsored immigrant families ever since Hungarians back in the 1950s. And I've been disturbed about some of the rhetoric, especially since the family that we are sponsoring and caring for is Muslim. I call that family regularly to let them know that some of that negative rhetoric that they undoubtedly are aware of, that's not us. We love them. And the other day, as I spoke to the husband of the family, he says, you keep calling. We know who you are. We are salt. We are light. We are the living Jerusalem. We want to live as a child.